Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this Palm Sunday, or also the Sunday of the Passion. Coming to you live from Christ Church Beaurepaire in Beaconsfield. Now, as you know, traditionally on Palm Sunday we have a nice procession with palms and everything. We can't do that this year because it's an online service, and even if we were gathered in the church building, we couldn't process around because we can't do processions right now. So we're doing our best to replicate the experience, and you can enter into it mentally, into the spirit of Palm Sunday. So we begin with the Liturgy of the Palms. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Dear friends in Christ, during Lent we have been preparing for the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery. On this day, our Lord Jesus Christ entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph. The people welcomed him with palms and shouts of praise, but the path before him led to self-giving, suffering, and death. Today we greet him as our King. Although we know his crown is thorns and his throne a cross, we follow him this week from the glory of the palms to the glory of the resurrection by way of the dark road of suffering and death. United with him in his suffering on the cross, may we share his resurrection and new life. Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy into the celebration of these mighty acts, whereby you give us life and immortality through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The Palm Sunday Gospel is from Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Mark 11, 1 through 11. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door, outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise
to you, Lord Jesus Christ. We will now bless the palm crosses that our altar guild had worked so diligently making yesterday. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along the way. Bless these branches and all who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And now we will symbolically join in procession. And you can stand it at home, and if you have a piece of clothing or a scarf or something, or even any kind of branch, you can wave it around as we sing our opening hymn, which is normally a processional hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in tender love for all our human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take our flesh and suffer death upon a cruel cross. May we follow the example of his great humility and share in the glory of his resurrection through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Our Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 50, verses 4 through 9a. Isaiah 50, 4 through 9a. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is Psalm 31, verses 9 through 16. If you have a book of alternative services, that's on page 740. Psalm 31, 9 through 16. We will say it responsively by half verse. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble.
My eyes is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly.
For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing.
My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed.
I have become a reproach to all my enemies, and even to my neighbors.
I dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the street, they avoid me.
I am forgotten like a dead man, out of mind.
I am as useless as a broken pot.
For I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around.
They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life.
But as for me, I have trusted in you, O Lord.
I have said, you are my God.
My times are in your hand.
Rescue me from the hands of my enemies and from those who persecute me.
Make your face to shine upon your servant.
And in your loving kindness, save me.
And together we pray, Helper of the helpless, comfort of the afflicted, may your servants who stand in the midst of evil find strength in the knowledge of your presence and praise you for the wonders of your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. The epistle reading is from the Epistle to the Philippians, chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Philippians 2, 5 to 11. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our Passion Gospel this morning is Mark 15, 1 through 39. Mark 15, 1 through 39. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews." They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull, and they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly this man was God's son." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Name the Holy Trinity, the source of all, the incarnate Word, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Palm Sunday, aka Passion Sunday, is a bit complicated because in a very short time you go from the Liturgy of the Palms to the first Passion reading, which leaves you kind of wondering what to preach on. But I prefer to leave the Passion for Good Friday, so I invite you to come back Friday at 11 to hear a sermon on the Passion. And today we'll stick with Palm Sunday. As a kid, I always used to look forward to Palm Sunday. The season of Lent is long, especially if you're a kid, and it coincides with the most boring, seemingly endless span of the school year between Christmas and Easter in bleak midwinter. But finally, after so many penitential weeks, after the cheerless winter months, finally the procession of the palms announces the imminent arrival of Easter. And what's more, Palm Sunday traditionally is one of those few occasions when the children actually get to do something during the service. In fact, in the church I grew up in, it was only the children who processed with palms, thus making it all the more special. In fact, I can honestly say that aside from Christmas pageants, some of my earliest church memories would be from Palm Sunday processions, because it's so tactile, so participatory and dramatic. Yet today there was no procession as such. We tried to kind of give the feel of a procession, but there wasn't an actual procession, and nor was there last year. And as I said at the beginning, even if we were having in-person worship, and technically we could have today, according to the government, it really wouldn't be the same without a palm procession. I mean, standing silently as we listen to all glory, laud, and honor, and not processing with palms, it's just not the same. I mean, if we haven't sung that processional hymn, all glory, laud, and honor, and I tell you, standing here in place singing it just felt wrong somehow. I really felt like my feet should be moving. If we haven't done that, if we haven't marched around carrying palms, you know, around the church, inside the church, perhaps even going outside and processing around the church, if we haven't done all that, it doesn't seem like we've really had Palm Sunday at all. But this year, we can't do any of those things. As we couldn't last year, we can't process, we can't sing. So here's hoping for next Palm Sunday. Of course, these two past Palm Sundays have been irregular. And we yearn to return to the normalcy of Palm Sunday with all the trappings of the procession and parading around, waving the branches of, I'll remind you, non-indigenous plants. Palms don't grow around here. And this traditional Palm Sunday routine looks very normal to us who've been going to church all our lives. Of course we wave palm branches. It's to commemorate Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. It's just something we do. We take it for granted. Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem is so familiar to us that we don't even stop to think how strange this whole scene is. For instance, Jesus has spent his whole public ministry using no other form of transportation but his feet. I mean, look in the Gospels, Jesus is walking all the time. He's walking everywhere, you know, Galilee and then Jerusalem. And those aren't close together. I mean, there's lots of walking, and it doesn't ever mention him needing to use any sort of animal. In fact, the only time, an animal being a form of transport appears in the infancy story when you know, Mary is riding a donkey. So he doesn't need, any sort of animal to transport him. Yet to enter Jerusalem, he needs to borrow a donkey or a colt and a donkey. It depends on which version of the gospel you read. They're all slightly different. He needs to borrow this animal for the occasion. And also, doesn't it strike you as odd that people would spontaneously gather to lay down their cloaks and branches on the road in front of Jesus? And I say branches because this is one of those areas where stories from the different Gospels have been fused into one. Mark doesn't say palms at any point. He says branches. Cloaks and branches, so clothes and the branches of some sort of plant. It's only John that mentions palms specifically, which is, curious that in North America we kind of insist that it has to be palms, but in certain countries, in northern countries, especially back in the day when transporting palms was impossible, people would use any sort of branches. Like in Eastern and Northern Europe, they use pussy willow branches. So it doesn't have to be palms, and it's not palm except in John's Gospel. But if we think about this whole scene with all these trappings, it almost seems a bit contrived or even staged. I mean, Jesus didn't need to borrow this donkey for transportation purposes. He could have easily walked. But because we know that he is quite used to walking, the fact that he borrows this animal, donkey or colt or whatever, specifically for this act, means that this is making a statement. A statement that has heavy political overtones as well. Because while the story of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem is very familiar to us. It's one of the more familiar stories from the Gospels. But there's another story of triumphal entry that we are unaware of. But it's the one that people in the day, in Jesus' time, would all have known. And that's the triumphal entry of Pontius Pilate. Of course, we know Pontius Pilate from the Passion story. That's the only place he shows up. And that's where he plays a key role. And we even repeat his name every time we say the creed, when we say he was crucified under Pontius Pilate or suffered under Pontius Pilate. But in the Gospel, we don't really get a backstory for Pilate. He just shows up and he does his thing and then he's gone. And because he is the Roman governor of Judea, and he seems to be in the neighborhood when Jesus is arrested, we tend to assume that he just lives there, that he lives in Jerusalem. Why not? That's what I always thought. Until recently, I was reading about this, and discovered that Roman governors didn't normally live in Jerusalem. Roman governors like Pontius Pilate found Jerusalem to be unpleasant. It's insular, provincial, and it's hostile to Gentiles. And it's probably an uncomfortable place to live because it's not near the sea. It's landlocked, it's an old city that's crowded, lots of strife, and perhaps even diseases running through it. The Roman governors preferred a more comfortable residence, and for most of the year they lived in a city on the Mediterranean Sea, in what's now Israel, but on the coast, a place called Caesarea Maritima, which is a Roman city they had built. And the Roman governor would only go into Jerusalem for major Jewish festivals. Not because they were pious Jews, but rather it's when these festivals happen, that problems tend to happen because people's religious fervor is stirred up and their nationalistic sentiment gets stirred up. And if there was going to be a riot or an insurrection or some sort of uprising, it would be during a festival. And this is the festival of the Passover, which our Jewish brothers and sisters are celebrating the Passover right as we speak. So Pilate has to make his way from Caesarea Maritima to Jerusalem. And because he's a Roman official, and because Rome always needs to make its power clear, he needs to make an entrance. He needs to make a grand entrance that impresses upon the people that Rome is in charge and Rome rules the world. You know, a full imperial procession with, probably a chariot with a white horse and a full complement of soldiers, centurions, armor, swords, you know, Roman banners flailing. All the power, might, and glory of Rome on full display, reminding the people of Jerusalem exactly who was in charge and exactly what their place was. Pilate's procession carried, of course, a clear political message. Peace brought through force, order brought through oppression. But it also bore a theological message. Starting with Emperor Augustus, Roman emperors were referred to not only as Lord, but also as Son of God, King of Kings, Prince of Peace, and Savior of the world. Sound familiar? Well, Pilate represented both Roman political ideology and imperial theology. That the emperor is the best thing that has ever happened in the history of the world, and everyone should be grateful to the emperor. And also, Rome's God is superior to the Jewish God. And Rome was quite tolerant in allowing other religions to exist. But there was one catch, and that is everything is subordinate to Rome. As long as you recognize the power of Rome, you can worship your little your insignificant local deities. But Rome is in charge of the world. So that's happening on one side of the town, the main gate, where Pilate is entering through the main gate to make a grand imperial entrance. But on the other side of town, we have a different sort of procession. A man riding on a humble donkey or colt or whatever, but it's not a war horse, it's a humble animal. Surrounded not by soldiers, armed with swords, but with disciples armed with branches and cloaks. Yet, they are proclaiming him king. In some of the gospel it says, "Blessed is he, the king who comes in the name of the Lord." Now, and these actions and these words are not innocuous in the context we're talking about. They're a direct challenge to Roman political ideology and Roman theology, Roman state theology. These two triumphal entries, the triumphal entry of Pilate and the triumphal entry of Jesus, could not be more different. They're almost like a photo negative of each other. And Jesus' triumphal entry turns Pilate's triumphal entry on its head. And that's no accident. Pilate and Jesus represent opposing visions of the world. Pilate's vision, not his personal vision, but because he represents the Roman state, Pilate's vision is a world in which the strong dominate the weak, the rich exploit the poor, and which military strength and conquest are glorified, wealth and power worshipped. But Jesus offers an alternative vision, a vision of a world in which the poor, the weak, and the marginalized are lifted up, in a world in which every single human being is a beloved child of God, a world in which God is worshipped and love is the law. In other words, the kingdom of God. The individual Pontius Pilate is long dead, and except for his mention in the Creed and in the Passion Gospel once a year, Pilate is pretty much forgotten otherwise. And so is the Roman Empire, long dead, buried. But the vision represented by Pilate's triumphal entry, that symbolically is represented by Rome, this vision is still very much present with us. It's very much the way of the world. On Palm Sunday, we join symbolically in procession for our Lord Jesus Christ. And indeed very symbolically this year, because we couldn't actually process. But the point is clear. We join in procession to glorify Christ as King. But every day of our lives, we are faced with these two processions, these two conflicting understandings of the world and how the world should work and how we should live. One beckons with pomp and glory of the world, with greed and material success, and the other calls us to a kingdom of light, life, and love. Amen. Let us confess the faith of our baptism in the words of the Apostles' Creed, as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For the prayers of the people, we'll be using Litany 14, found on page 121 of the Book of Alternative Services. But first, we will have a time of intercessory prayer. So if you have prayer requests, requests for prayers of healing, of support, prayers of thanksgiving, that you can type them in the comments section and we'll pray together. God of healing, we lift up to you all of suffering humanity, and in particular, those who are suffering from COVID-19. We pray for those who are working in the medical profession and in supporting roles, those who are distributing vaccines, and those who are working on treatments. And we pray that we all may cooperate, work together, looking after one another to bring this pandemic to a quick end in which and that we don't lose more people. God of love and mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those in need in our own parish, those in need of healing and support, and those of our family. Pray for Anne, Eleanor, Christopher, Shirley, Art, Mary, Anne, Robbie. We also pray for Carl, Ellen, and Cody. We pray for those who are mourning, for Karen, Sandy and Ian, Ron, Nancy, Larry, Jeff and Andy, Sandra, Clifford, Cedric, and Michael, Linda and Steve.
We are praying for Elizabeth and Isabel. We are sending our healing prayers to Barbara, and also the prayers for the recently departed Kelly.
Lord, we pray for all who have died, especially those who have died recently. We commend them to your loving embrace. Lord, we pray for this diocese, we pray for our diocesan leadership, for Bishop Mary. We pray for all our clergy, for every parish, especially the parishes of the West Island, and in particular our own parish of Christ Church. We pray for your guidance and your strength as we navigate our way through this pandemic and how we emerge from it. God of love and mercy,
hear our prayer. We are praying for Sandy's cousin, Ray.
Lord, we pray for our ecumenical partners. In particular, we pray for the Scottish Episcopal Church and the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada, as well as all the churches of in our neighborhood, for our United Church neighbors, Presbyterian neighbors, Catholic neighbors, and others.
We are praying for Wayne's uncle Ross, so that he can access special meds for his heart.
We pray for the leadership of our country. We pray for our Prime Minister, Justin, our Premier, Francois, for our municipal leaders, and for Elizabeth, our Queen. And we pray for all the leaders of the nations, that they may be guided with wisdom and a spirit of cooperation as emerging from the global pandemic and solving our common humanitarian woes and economic woes requires participation from all of us. Let us work together in unity.
We are praying for Dawn, for his ALS. We are also praying for Anne in the hospital and hoping to be released soon.
Gracious God, you have heard all these prayers that we have spoken aloud and those that we have whispered silently in our hearts. All this we offer to you. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
With confidence and trust, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church throughout the world, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the Church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those preparing for baptism, for their teachers and sponsors, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For peace in the world, that a spirit of respect and reconciliation may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all whom we have injured or offended, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For grace to amend our lives and to further the reign of God, We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Our service continues with a confession. I invite you, as we say the confession together, to examine yourselves, your conscience, and offer all that is in need for forgiveness. Offer it to God. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Now take this time to share a sign of the peace of Christ with those in your household or in the comments section below the video. Peace of Christ. Let us pray. Gracious God, the suffering and death of Jesus, your only Son, makes us pleasing in your sight. Alone we can do nothing, but through his sacrifice may we receive your love and mercy. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. In union, blessed Jesus, with the faithful gathered throughout the world and throughout time at every altar of your church, we are blessed body and blood are offered. We long to offer you praise and thanksgiving for creation and all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. We believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament, and since we cannot at this time receive communion, we pray you to come into our hearts. We unite ourselves with you and embrace you with all our heart, soul, and mind. Let nothing separate us from you. Let us serve you in this life until, by your grace, we come into your glorious kingdom and unending peace. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now is our time for spiritual communion. As we listen to the hymn, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross, take this time to turn inward and commune with Christ in your heart. Together we pray. Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in our hearts in the fullness of your strength. Be our wisdom and guide us in right pathways. Conform our lives and actions to the image of your holiness. And in the power of your gracious might, rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom. With the Father and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. And together we pray. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. May the God of mercy transform you by his grace, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you now and forever.
Amen.
Announcements, and there are A lot of announcements, and they're important, so please bear with me. First of all, coffee hour, coffee fellowship, not necessarily an hour, but coffee fellowship. After this service on Zoom, you should have the Zoom link in your email, and it might be posted in the comments as well. It will start as soon as this service is over, more or less. It probably won't start at 11 because this service is running long, because Palm Sunday is always longer because of two Gospels. So hope to see you at coffee hour. Holy Week and Easter services. So for Holy Week, we're having two Holy Week services after this one. Maundy Thursday is 7 o'clock on Thursday. That will be a live broadcast. I'll broadcast from home. That's online only. And Good Friday at 11 o'clock a.m. broadcast from the church. That's online only as well. Please tune in for those services. For Easter Sunday, man, I think most of you have heard through some channel or another that we are going to open again for in-person services on Easter Sunday. The government has changed the rules so many times. At first, we were limited to 25, and we were asking people to pre-register. Now they've taken that cap off, so we can accommodate more people. Not hundreds more, but at least you don't have to register in advance. So if you feel comfortable coming to church on Easter Sunday, and you would like to, please do so. Don't hesitate. If you feel comfortable and you want to, please just come. That said, allow a few extra minutes, at the beginning of the service. Don't show up at the last minute, because we have protocols to carry out. You have to make sure everyone's wearing a procedural mask, okay? So it's not any mask, a cloth mask that you may have been used to using. The government is requiring that it's a procedural mask. Those are the ones that are either blue or black or white, the ones, the paper ones. We'll have some on hand. We'll have some on hand if you forget, but it's better if you have one, please bring it with you. Also, we'll be asking you the standard COVID questions about your health and travels and all that. So all that takes a little bit of time, so please allow for that, so we can, so you can get in and settled before the service starts. So in-person worship Easter Sunday, we'll be having communion. No registration required, but please plan to get here early. That said, the service will also be broadcast on Facebook Live and through all the channels like normal. So if you prefer to join us from home, you won't notice anything different, except that we'll be having communion instead of spiritual communion. So join as you are most comfortable. On that note, as far as music, of course, we're not allowed to sing as a congregation. Congregational singing is not going to come back for a while, probably not until everyone's vaccinated. So if you're worshiping in church, you won't be able to sing hymns. But through the magic of technology, as you heard a few weeks ago when we did that congregational version of Be Thou My Vision, people recorded their voices at home, and our music director, Sylvia, mixed them in a way that makes it gives you the impression that we're all singing together in church. And we're doing that again for Easter. You should have gotten an email about that with all the instructions about how to do it. Christ, the hymn is Jesus Christ is Risen Today. And I really encourage you to join in this. Don't think you have to be the best singer ever. Just what's important is participation and getting as many of our voices in there as possible to make this grand and glorious noise for this joyful noise to the Lord on Easter Sunday. So even though we won't be able to sing in church, you can sing in advance and it will sound like we're singing in church. So please get that done as soon as you can. What else? Palm crosses. Of course, we have lots of palm crosses. You see, there's lots here. We have like 350, I think, that our altar guild diligently folded for us yesterday in an amazing time. I don't know how they do that. I'm not that handy. But so we have lots of palm crosses here. Logistical problem is how to get them into your hands. So after much discussion, I think I'm going to leave a basket, one of the baskets, outside by the side entrance, the entrance by the parking lot. There will be a basket of palm crosses as of around noon today. So if you want a fresh one, you can come by and pick one or a few up for your friends. The rest, I think we're going to save for Easter Sunday, so when you come to church, you can pick some up for you and your family and friends. So I think that's how we're going to do that. Other announcements, let's see, all our Lenten programs went well and have basically wrapped up, except for our EcoFast continues for another week. I think that is all. I was afraid I'm going to forget something. So here's hoping that this will be the last Sunday we'll have spiritual communion for a good while, I hope, and that from next Sunday we'll be having in-person services from Easter on. But as I said, this week, Holy Week services are online only. Is that everything, right? Okay. So our closing hymn, My Song is Love Unknown, that's Common Praise 184, verses 1, 2, 3, and 6.